gang up and vote to elect their favorite corrupt politician, right? So they all voted for the person number five. But they are lazy, so on all other lists they vote randomly, right? And now we want to aggregate the votes. If you take either mean or median, of course person number five will win because he gets 45 votes and person number one gets only 15 votes, right? So now, here is the algorithm. What is this? This is simply sum. Okay, P denotes, okay, I didn't tell you, so I should have told you that. Okay, so in the baseline algorithm, when a voter votes, he confers his trustworthiness as a contribution. But you can kind of slightly tweak the algorithm so that his contribution is his trustworthiness on certain power, between 2 and 3, practical example show. What does this do? This kind of makes amplification. If T is large, when you square it or cube it, it will become even larger. So it spreads out the trustworthiness of voters, right? Makes the differences larger. So which alpha do you choose? This you have to decide by experiment on real life data. So if alpha is higher, if you take trustworthiness of a voter on higher power, what you get is a more robust system for collusion, against collusion, but then only kind of voters that are really kind of mediocre voters, their votes count. So it starts marginalizing a lot of voters. And in practice, just like PageRank, why 0.85 as probability of following the link? Because it works well in practice. So here, notice, so our R is our sigma here. So what do? We simply sum up the trust, so P is the round of iteration, right? In the beginning, P is equal to 0, right? So this is the trustworthiness of the voter taken to power alpha, and this is taken into account only if the voter V on the list L voted for item J. Right, because this is the rank of the jth item on the list L. Right, so this is just a kind of a trick to make this sum up only for voters who on that particular list voted for item J. Then this is just the normalization step, and this is our row. And then the trustworthiness is just, as we had it before, simply sum of rows of all objects that the voter voted for. So this is exactly this algorithm. So initial trustworthiness, everyone gets 1, right? Now, matrix of the ranks. So we have 7 voting lists. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So each row, and on every list you have 9 items. So for example here, voter number 1 got 14 votes. Let's see, is it that way? No, sorry, let's see, list is this. So these are the lists, and these are the, yeah. So number 1 got 14 votes, number 2 8 votes, number 3 6 votes, and so 4. And here you can see for the last list, all honest voters voted for number 1, and all the crooks voted for number 5. Right? Now we normalize this. And this is the table of ranks of all items on the list. And notice, Number one, the candidate chosen by the honest voter got 0.31, and voter number five got 0.94. Remember, only some of the squares have to equal to one, not some. Right? So now we do the following. Then we do the first round of iteration. You see, now this row is equal to 1, while here this row was equal to 0. So that's starting rank. After one iteration, notice what happens. The rank of the last voter increases to 0.39. This one slightly drops to 0.92. After two rounds of iteration, these are the trustworthiness of everyone, and you can see that kind of already the honest voters have higher trustworthiness ranks because there is significant kind of agreement among them, and the rest of the guys voted randomly. So here are the ranks after two iterations. This went up to 0.48, this drops for 0.87. And after, when you run this algorithm, you run it until the ranks do not change for more than 10 to the minus 4. And this is the outcome. Voter number one, even though only 15 voters voted for him, gets 0.96, while the choice of the crooks gets only 0.25. So the choice of honest voters, actually, honest voters manage to elect their favorite. So why did this guy got higher ranks? Because you see, people that voted, the honest people, were in much more agreement than the crooks who vote randomly on all lists, except the last one. So the number one candidate will get higher trustworthiness in its sum, and this gets amplified in the as the algorithm runs. And you can see these are the trustworthiness rank of honest people, and these are trustworthiness ranks of the groups, and you can see that. So even though the collusion was massive, it was 45 people trying to skew votes of only 15 people. Now, how can this be defeated? The colluders, what would colluders have to do if they want to change the outcome on the last list?
Yes. They have to be consistent with all of their...
They would have to make an effort to figure out what are the preferences of people on other lists and to vote accordingly.
If they were big enough, if there was 45 of them, couldn't they all just have agreement with each other?
Can you be a little bit louder? I'm old and deaf.
If there's a big majority of them, like 45, couldn't they just have an agreement for all of their decisions alone?
That's another, okay, so another option would be, rather than figuring out who, you're good at the, are you by any chance a Russian or Chinese hacker? Donald Trump told me, you guys are dangerous. So what these guys could, how they could screw up the system, they can simply say, forget what honest people think. All of us vote for the same person on every list. We don't care for whom. And then, but that's not how kind of, okay, so it is not, there is no silver bullet for any system if you know how it operates. So the colluders will have to know how the system works, which you don't have to advertise on your website, right? So, usually people concentrate on what they run. So what is this? So this, the student of mine, Mohammed, did it for evaluating movies. And interestingly enough, when you run this algorithm on IMDb, something like that, right? you get results that are between IMDb and Rotten Tomatoes, right? So it kind of pushes the evaluation. So I don't know how to interpret this, but as I say, the main use of this is to find community sentiment, not to find any truth. Now we have to address several issues about this, the first issue being that the lady brought up, which would be, is the following. If it's not the case that everyone votes for every, on every list, but some people can vote on very few, and some people can vote on a lot. And this precisely happens in the movie rankings, because majority of people rank between 10 and 100 movies. But there were loonies who ranked several thousand movies. So on one hand, you don't want these loonies to take over the system. So just this thing would be catastrophic. Even if they are outliers, if there are lots of these, if you sum up lots of small numbers, you can end up with large trustworthiness. So one option would be, instead of that, divide this by the number of R, such that, you divide this by, a number of R's, you divide this by, not there. Let me see, where do you change this? You divide this by the number of R's such that R, so we want to make sure this doesn't explode, we want to find mean. So yes, this would be just such that R voted LR. Yeah? All right? Because if I do that, then the trustworthiness, this is how many, so instead of simply summing up these guys to get this, I find their mean. Now the cardinality no longer matters. It's just whether, on average, you voted correctly. Well, that's bad again. Why? Assume that I voted for only one movie, right? And I happen to be smack accurate. My trustworthiness will be huge. But what's the value of a single vote? Maybe it's just a fluke. This is usually solved by sigmoid, or it's also called logistic functions, that look like this. They look, you can use arctan, for example, or logistic, which is hyperbolic, defined by hyperbolic functions. But the idea is like this. For smaller values, it's almost linear. So if you voted for about 10 movies, their rows will be simply summed up. But as it grows larger, this kind of has horizontal asymptote, and you discount extremely large values, right? So this is a compromise. So instead of this, so you would take average times, let's call this logistic of this number, logistic of R such that R LI. So for small values here, this will be linear. and it will cancel out that, so you will simply find the sum of these guys. But if these become excessively large, right, then this, the contribution of these, the multiplier, this will almost converge to the mean. Right, then with this, because this will become one, approximately one. So voila, this would be really interesting to implement this. No one, to my knowledge, has done this. Another problem with this would be the following. Here, we count just plain number of hits, whether you are correct or you are not correct, so to speak, if this is the preferred outcome. Well, assume that you have a market analyst that always is off by one, and another market analyst that is always on the opposite side. They would get exactly the same back, namely just the number of hits. So you want to extend these so that the ranks of nearby objects contribute also to the ranks of the object you have. So if you were slightly off, some of the credibility that this guy got will also confer to nearby guys. And this would produce, in my opinion, a better. When is that good? This is good when these are comparables. For example, if this is number of stars. But if these are people, there is no ordering between them. Right? So if the domain is not ordered, then this is the ideal algorithm. But if the domain is ordered, you might want to make tweaks to this formula. So for example, here, for the trustworthiness, you will not use just this, namely exactly trustworthiness of the guys that voted for LI, but plus some smallish number, maybe a quarter or so, say call alpha, times sum of R that voted on L, either for I minus 1 or for L I plus 1. Right, so this would give then to this contribution also from the trustworthiness of voters who voted for nearby objects. And similarly here, you can total not just exact hits, but plus some beta times sum rho L I plus 1 rho L or rho L I minus 1. You get the idea? So you delocalize the formulas. For example, for market analysts, right, it would be a good idea to kind of penalize differently if you are totally off from the consensus than if you are next to the consensus. So you see, you can test whether your algorithm converges. In all likelihood, I mean, there is a systematic way, and I'll put on the web page, it's a kind of theorem, what it has to satisfy so that the convergence proof works. It's a book chapter in some kind of collection of papers. So I'll scan it and put it, but you don't have to bother with that. Tweak the formulas and test whether it converges. If it converges, it tends to converge very fast. If it explodes, immediately it blows up. Right, the idea is to keep normalizing things because this guarantees that these guys are actually vectors on a unit sphere, right? And in fact, in the convergence proof, this is crucial that all these rows are just vector of rows are vectors on the unit sphere, and then you don't do gradient descent, but you go kind of in a, you will see if you read the proof. Anyhow, so the point is, this is a prototype of an iterative aggregation algorithm. Next week we will do, next week we will do another type of algorithms. Notice that here these are discrete choices. It's not that they give, for example, yearly earnings for the company, which is a real number. So how do you aggregate when the choices analysts make are not discrete, but are real numbers, right? And this is what happens. What happens, we came up with an algorithm that worked much better. It still works the best, to my knowledge, of all iterative filtering algorithms. But we never bothered to prove its convergence just because of this experience that they wouldn't publish the proof. So why do you prove something if you cannot publish it, right? Unless you are young and enthusiastic, and I'm not. So, and then we published this, and quite a few labs for sensor. This is used, this kind of stuff is used in aggregation of sensor readings, because some of the sensors can be compromised. So you want somehow, if you have measurements from several sensors, you want to aggregate in an optimal way. So lo and behold, in 2016, when I was teaching, I offer whoever breaks down the algorithm gets 100 in the course, right? So and because several labs around, they tried and they couldn't. That was after a day, I get from Ishraq an email, bloody bastard managed to break it. So, but then I actually didn't even have time. He explained to me it's a generalization of an attack that another student of mine designed. But what you can do is, I guess Ishraq wouldn't mind, I can ask him, I can send you his attack, and you try to fix the algorithm to survive this type, particular type of attack. And you will think that that's silly. Okay, let me tell you where this goes. Assume the following setup. Assume you have 10 voltmeters, right? And you are in a lab and you test them. Okay? And you see the voltmeter one, average, its variance, namely average variation from the true value is 0.1. Voltmeter number two has average variation, variance, right, 0.25. Voltmeter three has variation 0.75, and voltmeter four has variation 0.1. So you do this in a lab. And now, having these four voltmeters, you have to measure a voltage. How would you do it? Yes?
You would take a weighted average?
Shush. Yeah. How would you do it? How would you do it? You know, natural first, take this guy and measure it. Well, actually, that's not the case.
And how about weighted average?
Right? Exactly, that's what this goes too early. You are spoiling my show.
Sorry.
So the way to do it is to take measurement of voltmeter 1 and divide it by 0.1. Well, this is actually variance, 0.1 squared. Plus, you take measurement of voltmeter 2 and divide it with 0.25 squared, plus measurement of voltmeter 3, you get the idea, divide with 0.75 squared, plus measurement of voltmeter 4 divided by 0.01 squared. And then you divide by 1 over 0.1 squared plus 1 over 0.25 square plus and so forth, plus 1 over 0.01 squared. So you actually measure with all full volume. So, but you put, you make weighted average of the readings, where every voltmeter's reading is weighed by the reciprocal of the variance. So you can see here, this will be very, very small. So reciprocal will be very large. So this guy will get by far the largest weight. But what you get in this way is far more accurate than what you would get if you used only voltmeter 4. And in fact, one can show that this method is the most possible, most accurate possible method. Any other method that is unbiased will have variance larger than this method. Yes?
So does it mean if we scale up, no matter the accuracy of the, if we know the accuracy of the meters, would give us a more accurate?
Yes, more measurements with no matter what variances are, and you will see from simulation next time. This is obtained, as you will see, it's called maximum likelihood estimation, and it reaches the Kramer-Rao lower bound for the variance of unbiased estimate. So, yes?
So, say if I have a crab about the meters.
Sorry?
If we have a bunch of crab, very bad.
Yes.
We still can, if we scale up quite a lot of numbers,
you can measure. Of course, yeah, you get much better, so it significantly reduces the error. So, yes?
Do you have to assume that the variances are like Gaussian?
Do you have actually, I think you have to, you know, I haven't read this, I believe. Okay, this is how it works. Probably the theorem, no, actually, no. No. you know, I'm not sure, I would have to check, but I'm pretty sure actually, do you have to assume that it's Gaussian? Okay, well, probably you have to assume, I'll double check. I, you know, I see this once a year when I teach it. But something amazing happens in practice. So a lot of estimates work for Gaussian norms. But the algorithms actually perform well even when the noise is not Gaussian noise, but it has God knows what distribution. So what did I, now the point is this, what I want to make. But this is a ridiculous example for one reason. In real life applications, if you want to aggregate sensors, what are you, the variance of a sensor depends where it was dropped, right? So there is no way you can know the variance of the sensor. Moreover, assume that you are running a conference, right? And you have a bunch of referees, and you don't know these people. So each referee marks several papers, and every paper is marked by several referees. Referees you don't know, so you don't know what kind of errors they make, whether they are too stingy, too generous, or just assign random, right? So in real life, you will not know these numbers. You will have only the raw measurements. You want to produce an algorithm that has two properties. If the errors of the sensors are Gaussian with given variances, your estimate is close to the optimal one, the maximum likelihood estimate. So if you generate data with a Gaussian random number generator for the errors, your algorithm should output something that is very close to the theoretical optimum. But on the other hand, when you referee people's papers, use academics, they hate some people, right? So when you see who the author is, you trash their paper, right? And not only that, but you tell your buddies, look, this guy is, right? Let's give him a lesson, right? So you want that the system, when presented with the stochastic data of appropriate form, produces optimal result, but it is also robust against misbehavior. And this is the reason why people use these iterative filtering algorithms, which are kind of attempts to optimally aggregate data so that on stochastic data you get better, best results, but you are also very robust against collusions. So this is the next step, what we will do. You might want to kind of refresh what variance and you might want to read iterative filtering, just the beginning where it's basic statistics for the next slide. This is what we are going to do. Now, I have just enough time to tell you about other voting schema. Right. First, I told you about schema that my students invented, right? So, of course, this is the most important in the universe. But now I can tell you, you know, what's out there, right? So, people, starting from, I think, maybe 16th century, you know, with the early advent of democracy, right, were curious how to aggregate votes. So assume that you simply have an election for the mayor, for example, and you have, say, candidates A, B, C, D, and you have gazillions of votes. Each person votes for one person. Who wins the election? Or even better, if this is ranking people by popularity, how do you rank people to reflect the votes that they got? So the most obvious solution is what's called majority voting. You count for each person how many times he was placed first, right? And that's his rank, how many, then the next person, how many times he came first. First choice, I'm messing it up. So each voter actually gives you a rank list of candidates according to preferences, just in, like in our voting system, right? You have preference, right? And if you are a loony, you put Pauline on top, right? And you know, I hear that she's in critical condition because she heard that there are Asians who are also Muslims. So you make a rank list, right? I shouldn't be telling you all these things. I keep forgetting that this thing is recording, right? But Australian politics, you know, all this bickering really pisses me off. So my wife and I went voting, and I was really pissed. So I looked, which is how should I vote? So I said, look. What's the most outrageous choice? Sex party, number one. Number two, hunters and fishermen party. Number three, Marxist-Leninist party, you know. Right, and then labor and liberal on the bottom. Just, anyhow, so, and my wife wanted to kill me for that. But that's not the only time that she wanted to kill me. So the point is, every voter gives you the rank list. How do you aggregate this multitude of rank lists into a single ranking list? So majority voting puts on top the person who was placed first on as largest thing possible, the largest list possible. Then the next person will be the person who was placed first, you know, the second largest number of votes. And so forth, and you know, maybe you break evens any way you want. That's called majority voting. Then there is what's called border count, right? The first one is kind of a bit strange, because what if someone never got first, but it's often second, you know? It doesn't look like a good way to aggregate the votes. Border list, border voting does the following. Say if you have n candidates, on each list, the top candidate gets n minus 1 points, second candidate gets n minus 2 points, the last candidate gets no points, and then you sum total across all the voting lists. And then the scores, ordering of the scores, tell you the final ordering. And there is Condorcet voting that proceeds as follows. You pick any two pairs of candidates, and you see on how many lists A is above B versus on how many lists B is above A. And then if A is above B more often than B is above A, and you make a constraint that in the final outcome A should be above B. Now, what's the problem with all these three voting types? Well, as a homework, and for you to practice to use Mathematica, you have to produce a voting list so that according to majority vote, it's A, B, C. According to border, B comes first. And according to Condorcet, C comes first, right? So they are obviously totally inconsistent. So how do you aggregate the votes? Well, no one knows, right? In fact, there is a depressing result called the Arrow's impossibility theorem that formulates a bunch of axioms that will sound perfectly natural, that any good voting schema should have these properties. Then Arrow proved that there is no voting schema that satisfies all these axioms, right? But we don't have time to go into these details. So next time we will first discuss voting, because Ishraq and Ray actually came up, while I was writing the notes, I came up with a hypothesis and I leave it to the students. And lo and behold, the two bloody bastards came up with a beautiful solution. So